Planning Panel. The first item of business is the appointment of the Chair. Do I have any nominations?
I will nominate Councillor Gilchrist.
That's unanimous, Councillor Gilchrist.
I take my own pleasure.
Well, we have a procedure labelled Appendix 4, which leaves me circulated, sent to members and officers. I wonder whether that procedure has been made available to all the members of the public.
I think so.
So that they can understand where we're going if we go in any particular direction. Opening remarks to the chairperson. These panels occur, thankfully, very rarely, but always in sensitive circumstances. So, as Chair, I will ensure that in line with the procedure, everyone has the opportunity to make submissions and that they're treated fairly throughout. Section 4 is the panel to determine whether the exception to exclude the press and public is to be maintained. Documentation has been provided to all members, but is exempt as a pack of information. It includes the comments from a number of complainants. In order to help the panel consider whether the exemption is to be maintained or removed, I'm happy to take representations about that.
I understand from speaking to the councillors involved that people have no major objection to the matter being held in public.
Right. Well, thank you for making those inquiries, as it has something that I want to establish.
Mr. Cardin, as the complainant, may also wish to make a comment.
On this issue about openness. Mr. Cardin, yes.
Just to say that that's good that he's expressed that view and it can go ahead and public. Right.
If the panel has a formal vote on that, sure. But I just want to check whether the members have a contrary view or a comment on it.
Just to ask if the documentation of the complaints, if other complainants other than Mr. Cardin are happy for their complaints to be resolved.
I have to ask the officer that wrote the report. As I recall it, the complaints didn't identify names and addresses but were named individuals. Do you have any information on that, Ms. Shaw?
There was in the complaints form, complainants are asked whether they wish their identity to be kept confidential. One complainant did ask for their identity to be kept confidential. I responded to them and said that I didn't think it was appropriate in the circumstances or necessary for confidentiality to be maintained, but could they let me have their views as to whether they wished to continue with that, and they responded to me by email and confirmed that they were happy for their name to be not kept confidential. I've sent copies of my report to all of the complainants, and with the exception of Mr. Cardin, none of them have responded to my email saying here is a copy of the final report and that the matter was going to be heard this evening and would they like to attend.
So, as things stand, we've heard that the councillor who complained about is willing contempt for the matter to be held in public. We've heard that the complainants know about that situation and that there's a report that will be issued, made available once we cease to be exempt, and a member's contempt was to be held in public. Right. And our independent member. The procedure allows me to ascertain your views every now and again, but mainly towards the end of the proceedings, but you know exactly where I'm going.
Yes.
Thank you. So, Chair, resolution about that.
Yes. Yeah. Before we proceed any further, could we just confirm that there are no declarations of interest?
Oh, thank you.
With
it was item 2 on our running list, yes. Now, members, of course, but we understand.
I don't think this Councillor Rennie's husband was my son, wasn't it?
Oh my God.
But that's 20 years ago. I don't mean that.
Well, I'm not sure if that right, so as things stand, we have a formal vote on the proceedings taking place in public and the complaints, identity being known from the paperwork and the documentation that we have will be made public. The members agree with all that.
Okay.
So we need, therefore, to invite the centre officer out to bring in the member that's the subject of the complaint.
Could we have a copy of the papers as well, if possible?
Mr. Hughes is on the case. Chair has been.
Oh, right, thank you.
Worry about that big file, it's not new material.
Yes.
Well, we're going on the report that we received, of course, though, because there are opportunities for complainants and yourself to make representations. There's a procedure that's just been put on the table in front of you, which
yes, I have had that.
And we have got through section 4 by your very presence and the public being present, we've determined that we shall have this hearing in public.
Yeah.
And that means that the documentation that members have been supplied with the standards panel has been given to the members of the public over there. And the next section we got as far as number 5 on the order. Complainant or representative invited to make opening remarks. Now, the complainant is sitting behind you, and if you'd like to come forward, sir, and just for the record, give your details of your actually not address, but identity will be known and addressed down to most members, I think. But
yeah, I'm Paul Cardy, member of the board, council taxpayer. I've been a blog as well for about 8 years. It's called Wirral, all in it together. I think more about that. But, I noticed a tweet that had been sent on the 16th or 17th of July this year by Councillor Burgess-Joyce. And it was a response to David Lang, MP, who was a black MP. Can I read it out now?
It is in the document pack, and it was published. If it's a matter of, I think we're quite content to hear it. We know that members are familiar with the material, so it is on the document pack. Yeah. So if you've got a document pack, is Mr. Carlin got a document pack? So it's probably easier if we ask you to refer to it by referring to where it is in the document pack. In my document pack, it would be, trusting it is the large print version after page 61, which is about 5 sheets from the back, 3 sheets,
yeah.
4 sheets from the back.
Well, got it, yeah.
And if Mr. Shaw, that's VS2 is what we're about to hear. So, you're drawing our attention to The on page 61, the one that opens Mr. Lamy. Yes.
Yeah.
So we have that before.
Yeah, for context, there was a response to David Lamy's tweet sent a day earlier. Yeah. He said 24 hours later, and it is deeply disappointing that neither Boris Johnson nor Jeremy Hunt have condemned Donald Trump's vicious racist tirade on four congresswomen. At the next PM, we'd rather hand on to Parliament. Councillor Lady Burgess-Joyce responded, Mr. Lamy, if Mr. Trump is racist, then he's no doubt learned it from you. You're an expert in virtue signalling black issues. You pretend to speak for black people, yet you do more damage to community cohesion than any KKK member, which is Ku Klux Klan member.
The document pack on page 45, let everyone turn to that. Your name appears before what's called complaint detail, and that is the basis of your complaint and you've listed the desired outcome. So, So, do you want to make some opening remarks about that?
Just as it stands, the desired outcome, I believe, the tweet to be both criminal and racist and offensive. But I trust that the council standards complaint procedure can now be used to investigate this urgently and to apply a measure of accountability for any crime committed or public offence caused. Just to add a little bit to that, I'm quite surprised it's taken 6 months to get to where we are. It's taken a long time.
Well, I think Ms. Shaw's comments may give an explanation for that. And you've raised that issue, so I'll just make a note of time as an issue for you on my little running sheet. These are opening remarks, so have you covered the opening remarks? Draw your attention to your complaint and what it's about.
Just to say that I know the council standards procedure is being reviewed when Sergeant Saul is the monitoring officer. I'm wondering how well that was done, given that it's been such a delay. Yeah. But that's it, really.
Thank you. So you raised concerns about the delay, and I've made a note of that. You've done the opening remarks. So section 6 is the subject councillor, which is Councillor Burgess-Joyce, invited to make opening remarks. So can we hear from you, please?
Thank you, Chair. I come here today with all of the facts before you. It's quite easy to be quite factual when it's done on social media. What I hope to prove today to the panel is that, one, my sincerity with regards to my apology to Mr. Lamy, which I made on the day and which still sits on my Twitter page. The rationale behind why I made it and some mitigation, although this is not an excuse for certain mitigations to why, and also to counter what Mr. Cardin has said from a number of points of view. Mr. Cardin and I ironically have something in common, which is that we're both very passionate about urban government. We may differ on politics, but we do have a passion for doing things for the right reason. Differences, I stood for Parliament, I stood for the council, he hasn't. And I want to really bring to the table.
Yeah, that's a bit of a slur, isn't it?
I think it might be a relevant comment, Mr. Burgess.
Well, I thought of the following.
Can remarks be made through me? And whilst I appreciate some background, we're looking at the exact.
Okay, we'll just have a chance to respond.
Yeah, I will consider that an appropriate time. I don't want Councillor Burgess-Joyce to depart into other areas as aren't covered by the report.
I just want to give some context to possibly.
Context, I'm being careful about, but you said you weren't making excuses and there's some mitigation. So you just make these the opening remarks.
I've finished my opening remark.
Thank you. Right. The report was put together by Ms. Vicky Shaw, and Section 7 invites us to ask you to present it, please.
Yes. Members, I'm sure, have read the report in detail, so I won't go through it word for word, but I'll highlight the main points. 7 complaints were received from members of the public in relation to the alleged conduct of Councillor David Burgess-Joyce. The complaints all related to a tweet which was posted on social media in July 2019. I met with Councillor Burgess-Joyce and gave him the opportunity to explain his actions, and the conclusion of my report is that there has been a failure to comply with the members' code of conduct. I've outlined in section 1 the relevant legislation relating to standards, which is found in the Localism Act of 2011, and section 52 of the Local Government Act 2000 contains the duty for a councillor to comply with the code of conduct. And I've set out at the top of the third page the provisions of the code of conduct, which I think are relevant in this particular case, which are: when acting in the role as a member of the council, the member should treat others with respect and not conduct themselves in a manner which is contrary to the council's duty to promote and maintain high standards of conduct. It's my understanding that Councillor Burgess-Joyce has been a member of the council since May of 2015. The background facts to this matter, to some extent, have already been explained to the panel, but I summarise them in my report as that in July 2019, a tweet was posted on social media, and that tweet, as we've already identified, is at Exhibit VS2 to my report. On the 17th of July, 7 members of the public submitted complaints about the tweet to the monitoring officer under the council's procedure for making complaints about members. There was also an article appeared on the BBC website on the 17th of September and an article in the Liverpool Echo on the 24th of July. I've detailed in the report the complaints that have been received and what the complainants said their complaint was and what their desired outcome was. As I've already explained, was one member of the public who asked for their identity to remain confidential, but following correspondence with them, they agreed that their name could be disclosed. I spoke to Councillor Burgess-Joyce about the matter. He accepted without hesitation that he'd made an inappropriate analogy in his tweet, and he explained his personal circumstances at the time, but accepted that there was no excuse for his actions, and that he stated that having made the comments and realised that the analogy he'd used was wrong, he apologised on Twitter. He also sent a formal letter of apology, which he published on Twitter, and pinned that to the top of his Twitter thread. So the findings of fact that I made were that it wasn't disputed that Councillor Burgess-Joyce had posted the tweet on social media, that the wording had caused offence, which resulted in 7 complaints being received from members of the public. Councillor Burgess-Joyce accepted when interviewed that he'd used an unacceptable analogy, and the tweet had been removed, and the apology and formal letter of apology had been posted publicly on his Twitter account. And the other finding was that Councillor Burgess-Joyce was suspended by the Conservative group as a result of his remarks. The reasoning as to whether there's been a breach of the code of conduct, the test in deciding that is objective: would a reasonable person aware of all material facts and ignoring all immaterial factors consider that there's been a breach? The code of conduct only applies to a member when acting in an official capacity and not at any other time. So I considered the question of, was the member acting in an official capacity at the time? Clearly, members use social media for both personal and the official capacity. And there have been a number of cases recently which suggest that the high standards expected of public office holders, well, there are high standards expected of public office holders even when they purport to use social media in a personal capacity. I also recognise that there is a difference between the actions which bring a councillor into disrepute and those which diminish the reputation of their office or the authority of which they are a member. I reviewed Councillor Burgess-Joyce's use of Twitter. On his profile page, he is registered as Councillor Burgess-Joyce, thereby making a clear reference to his role as an elected member. And he informed me that he mainly uses his Twitter account for council-related business, although he does sometimes use it in a personal capacity. It appeared to me that those who engaged with Councillor Burgess-Joyce on Twitter knew that he was a member of the council, and clearly seven people knew to make they could make complaints to the council about councillors. However, there is clear case law precedent which says that being known as a councillor in the relevant situation is not sufficient to engage the code of conduct unless the context is sufficiently related to the council or constituency business to bring the individual within the ambit of the code. When considering the tweet relating to this investigation, I think it's clear that Councillor Burgess-Joyce could not be said to have been directly conducting council business. He'd never been instructed by the council to represent the local authority on Twitter or engage with the public in the way that he did. And in addition, he never purported to be representing the council when expressing his views. Clearly his opinion was his own and was not that of the authority. It's my view, however, that when a member of the council wants to involve themselves in public comment on social media, if they want to do that in a personal capacity, they should make it explicitly clear that they're doing that in a personal capacity and not acting as a councillor. Councillor Burgess-Joyce didn't do that. It's also my view that councillors should expect that their behaviour in public is rightly under public scrutiny and therefore should adhere to the seven principles of public life, which I outline later on in the report, and are selflessness, integrity, objectivity, accountability, openness, honesty and leadership. Also, Councillor Burgess-Joyce's Twitter account was open to the general public. There were no privacy settings on it. And his Twitter page does, in other tweets, refer to council business and other rural councillors, as well as national political issues. So I came to the conclusion that my view was, in this particular instance, he was acting within his official capacity. The second issue that needs to be addressed is, has there been a breach of the code? Again, in my report, I've set out the relevant sections of the code that I referred to earlier. And under the Localism Act, the code, when taken as a whole, has to be consistent with the seven principles of public life, which I just outlined a few seconds ago. Clearly, it's within the rights of elected members to challenge other politicians and to make comments about them. Those challenges and comments can be robust and confrontational. In considering whether there's been a failure with the Code of Conduct, I've had regard to Article 10 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which is the right of freedom of expression. And obviously that's a crucially important right in a democratic society, and it can only be interfered with where there are convincing and compelling reasons justifying that interference. And if comments amount to political expression, then enhanced protection applies. And Article 10 protects not only the substance of what it's said, but also the form in which it's conveyed. And in the political context, it has been held that the immoderate, offensive, exaggerated and aggressive may be tolerated where it would not be tolerated otherwise. And Article 10 also protects the right to make incorrect but honestly made statements. The courts have recognised that the term political expression has broad application, extending to all matters of public administration and public concern, including the manner of the performance of public duties by others, and that politicians are subject to wider limits of acceptable criticism and are expected to be more thick-skinned and tolerant to comment than ordinary citizens. Nevertheless, there are limits to what amounts to acceptable public criticism, and such comments that are in the, nevertheless, protecting the individual's private interest, such as reputation, must be weighed against open discussion of matters if the relevant comment was made by a politician in political expression. And where the line is crossed is a matter which requires an evaluative judgment involving a number of factors that have to be weighed together. The comments made in this case were, in my opinion, political comments. I think we have to recognise that Mr. David Lammy MP is a senior politician and a very experienced public figure, and he does have the right and ability to respond to comments made about him by others. However, having carefully considered all of the facts and weighed all the factors involved in this matter against the interest of open and discussion of matters of public debate, my view was that I believed in this particular situation Councillor Burgess-Joyce failed to comply with the Code of Conduct, and therefore my finding was that there had been a failure to comply with paragraphs 1 and 2 of the members' code of conduct. That's the content of my report. I'm happy to answer any questions. I appreciate that these matters do take some time. Obviously, the complaints, a number of the complaints were first received on the 17th of July. Unfortunately, in relation to Mr. Cardin, his initial complaint, which he submitted on the 17th of July, for some reason, which I can't really explain, was automatically diverted by our IT system into my junk email. So it wasn't until he emailed me again on the, I think it was around about the 5th of August, that I actually realised that he'd submitted his complaint on the 17th of July. So there was a delay of 7 weeks there. As I said, I did have to do some communication with the individual who wished their identity to be kept confidential. August was, of course, the holiday period, and so that caused some a short amount of delay in terms of speaking to an independent person. And then there has been time, it has taken me some time to do the research, obviously, and prepare my report in relation to this matter. We were, I think, also, due to the calendar of meetings that the council has in the autumn period, it did take a little while to find a date when members were available. I think from about the end of October we were consulting members about availability for a panel date. So I do appreciate that, as I say, these things take little time, but I have endeavoured where I can to abide by the timescales within the protocol, but for certain reasons it wasn't always possible to comply with those as strictly as I might have liked.
Right. So, you've set out the clear points in the report we wish to draw our attention. Section 8 is where the parties are invited to question you for some clarification. I'll take Mr. Cardin first to see if you, sir, have any questions or clarification on the report or any questions you want to ask Ms. Shaw.
Yeah, with it being Twitter, it's not just a local issue, it's a national, it's global as well. So, an incident like this has a much further reaching impact than when you sat there and you sent the tweet and perhaps not realised. Well, obviously you do know that, but now.
Sorry, you'd like to direct remarks.
Oh, okay, sorry.
You want to say that if Mr. Burgess-Joyce realises, etc., that's a matter that you direct at me.
Sorry.
Or Ms. Shaw, as to whether she has an opinion on the extent of Twitter.
Yeah, that really, I'm not sure you mentioned that sort of aspect of how damaging to the reputation of the council, not just for the council or the party.
I have tried to recognise that obviously if members want to involve themselves in public comment on social media, then obviously that is open to the general public, and as you say, these days anybody anywhere in the world really can access social media. I accept that.
Mr. Burgess-Joyce, Councillor Burgess-Joyce, have you got any questions or matters of clarification?
Thank you, Ms. Shaw, for obviously doing a very fulsome report, which I struggle to argue with, really, to be honest. I think the only clarification that I probably do require, and I know you did touch on it, and I think Mr. Carter may appreciate this, I wasn't sending a tweet to sending it to a very robust politician who, it is fair to say, has called Conservatives worse than Nazis, has caused a whole host of very unpleasant things that have caused children in need to lose significant amounts of money because of his use of the words white saviours aren't required anymore. So the individual we're talking about is not a shrinking violent. So my argument is on the point around Article 10.
some quotes here from a government report. So more generally, if you'll allow me, Chair, sorry.
I'll just think about that for a minute. We're straying, perhaps, if it had been sent to anyone referring to the Ku Klux Klan, regardless of whether they're MP or not, that's something members may bear in mind, I can accept that a description of politicians expected to have thicker skins, well, as members have brought up with that. But we need to look at it in the context of would that have been with you? You have some prime knowledge of Mr. Lammy, which may have influenced what you wrote.
I'm just wondering, because obviously I've never sat in one of these before, and I'm not sure at which point you want me to make some form of...
There will be a chance for you to come and make a final submission later.
So on that particular issue?
But really, try to explore whether there's an issue where you disagree with Mr. Shaw.
I'll get into his chair if you don't mind. Yeah, it was around Article 10 of the European Court of Human Rights, and it talks about, more generally, freedom of political debate is at the very core of the concept of a democratic society, which prevails throughout the Convention. Subject to paragraph 2 of Article 10, it is applicable not only to information or ideas that are favourably received or regarded as inoffensive or as a matter of indifference, but also to those that offend, shock, or disturb. Such are the demands of that pluralism, tolerance, and broad-mindedness without which there is no democratic society, and for which I actually support Mr. Carlin's views on his ability to say things which also shock his brother and children.
That's not relevant, I think. We're dealing with what you're
looking at. Right. If you'll allow me, Chair, I'm talking about Article 10.
Article 10 need not refer to Mr. Carlin's actions elsewhere, I think.
An obligation to offer an apology is arguably a breach of the rights to hold an opinion because one is being forced to say something. So my argument with regards to Article 10 is that though I have made it perfectly and abundantly clear at every single point that I found the analogy wrong, I don't think I could have done more to apologise had I gone down to see Mr. Lammy in London. But my argument is that in a healthy debate of a political nature, sometimes we offend each other. There was no intention, I confess, to offend in that way. But after the fact, I have offended somebody who is quite happy to offend anyone else. So the clarification is, am I entitled, as a rebuttal, to quote Article 10?
I think, obviously, you can put to the panel your views about Article 10. I think I have accepted him, pointed out in my report that David Lammy MP is a senior politician. He is a very experienced public figure. He does have the right to respond to comments that are made about him in public, and he can respond publicly. I've also accepted that in a political context, said the immoderate, offensive, exaggerated, and aggressive may be tolerated where it would not be otherwise. The line can be crossed in certain circumstances. Where the line is crossed is a matter for evaluative judgment to be made, taking into account all of the factors. My view is that in this particular instance, the line has been crossed, but obviously it's a matter for the panel to make their decision, having heard or read my report and having considered your representations that you will make to them, they will form their own judgment about that.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you. That was just that clarification.
Thank you. So, if we move on to section 9, which is where the panel can question the investigator on her report. So, I'll ask members if they've got questions that they'd like to put in the show. Any members have a question? Councillor Stewart.
I'm not sure whether this is for Vicky.
Could you speak up?
Sorry, I'm not sure whether this is for Vicky. Just some clarification on the suspension of the member from the party, the Conservative Party, whether it's the Conservative group that he's been suspended from or whether it's the Conservative Party that he's been suspended from.
There is a reference in the report to the suspension on the Conservative Party. However, the recollection that Mr. Burgess, somewhere in the report, says that it was expected to be lifted at some point, or words to that effect. But I think
my understanding is that Councillor Burgess-Joyce has been suspended, and I have used the word party, but I appreciate I might have used the wrong word in relation to that. Perhaps Councillor Burgess-Joyce would be better to explain exactly what the situation is.
Well, take the clarification. There's a difference between the group and the party. It is known amongst members and from the press that you were suspended from the Conservative group. In the documentation, I think there's a reference to the matter being referred to a board of the Conservative Party, and a view being expressed by the board. For purposes of clarifying things, can you perhaps help us on that point, Mr. Burgess-Joyce?
Yes, and I will obviously defer to my good colleague as the deputy leader. My status within the group was a suspension notice received from the leader of the group on the 17th of July. Yes, July, the day of the event. So I had the whip removed on that day. The Conservative Party also, because obviously they've been contacted quite rightly by the leader of the group, suspended me from the Conservative Party. And that board has sat, and its decision, some very august people who I've never heard of, sat and decided that I had been inappropriate in my analogy, and as such, the suspension once over, that is the end of the matter as far as the Conservative Party is concerned.
Can I just clarify that? They considered it, decided that there had been a previous suspension, but they then restored your membership?
I do not have my membership currently restored. I have to sit out a period of time, which was originally 6 months, and that period will come to an end in the next month, 6 weeks over time.
Very much. So just clarify as where we're up to, I think.
I have written evidence, Chair, if that's of any benefit to you.
Right, go back to the questions. Councillor Stewart, did that come to the point you raised?
Yeah, it was just about point of party, because like yourself, I'd had group and party, so I just want to hand the report. So I just wanted to just do that.
Any comments with further questions? So, if we're content to get with section 9, the complainant is invited to make a final submission. So, Mr. Carden, if you'd like to make a final submission, we have to reach the panel to make some clarification on any points from you.
Or if it becomes just that sort of decision, hopefully there's a case to answer.
content you've made your final submission. Are there any points that the panel would like to put to Mr. Carter?
And I'll cut on that, Jack. There's a chance that we could have the shutters very
open. Yes, sir. I found it very hot and stuffy when I first came in the room. And working outdoors as I was, I found it not too hot and stuffy. Thank you. So, as long as the actions of the curtain have prevented anyone from hearing the proceedings properly. Disturbance to me. Thank you. So, as I recall, panel haven't got any clarification they wish to make. Oh, Mr. Sorry, so, sorry, Cassius, you had.
Yeah, we're thinking you want that. Ed, just would the comments perhaps be incredibly racist? Did you report that to the police?
No,
it
didn't.
No. Okay. Chair.
Yeah.
Is the investigator or the council in question aware that they're being reported to the police?
I'm not aware of any reports being made to the police.
Okay,
are we content that we've explored all that? And at this point, we're inviting Councillor Burgess-Joyce to make a final submission, following which there may be clarification sought by members.
Thank you, Chair. Firstly,